I am so glad that I'm not teaching dance classes because it would be so hard to put all these squares into a nice circle. But anyway, today is just a presentation using this technology, and I'm really glad, as I was saying before, to have this kind of homecoming and be in Edmonton. I feel a little bit of sunshine coming in through some of the windows, which is really good because in Brussels, the sun has set a couple of hours ago. So it's nice. I would like to speak today on a topic that relates a little bit to the one that was in the last Folklore Lunch by Natalia Khanenko-Friesen, because she was analyzing, looking at people's narratives when they were doing personal experience stories. And there's a lot of that involved in the research that I've been doing in the last couple of years, and particularly in this presentation. I gave an earlier version of this presentation about a year ago in Halifax in Pier 21. The Wirth Institute had a conference there called Transatlantic Dreams. I've changed especially the second half of the presentation quite a bit, but I understand that the Folklore Lunch is a venue where we can kind of grow presentations and share them to a new audience. And that's what I'll be doing tonight as well. Or sorry, this afternoon as well. So in any event, I'd like to talk about steamship agents. I want to focus on migration narratives, and there are lots of stories by a variety of different sources of people about migration from Central Europe coming to the Americas before 1914. There were literally hundreds of thousands of Ukrainians and Poles and German-speaking people, and lots of people coming to Brazil in particular, the United States in particular, Canada a little bit later than those two, but also in that pre-1914 period. And for many of us, Ukrainians coming to Canada is a kind of the more focused interest, including to myself, where 160,000 estimated people came in. And the number of Poles going to Brazil was at least as large as that or larger, etc. So these narratives are talking about, I'm really interested right now in the migration, the journey itself. And the narratives talk an awful lot about what happened as these people left their hometowns or villages, and then all along the journey and as they were arriving until they got to their home place in the new continent, wherever that was. And the stories are really diverse and really conflicting with each other. And that's what I'm trying to understand a little bit today and share with you. A lot of that diversity is because with so many thousands of people traveling, some of them had a good journey and some of them had a terrible journey. So a lot of the diversity of the stories is because of the diversity in the experiences at the moment of migration. But a large part is also related to the moment of narration. So it's when the author writes about what happened during the journey that also changes the story quite a bit. And that's what I want to explore now. But let's go to a couple of examples. So here is one taken from a history. The Hotel des Auteurs, where the Hapag Steamship Company had their office, was transformed into a torture hall. The beginning was usually calm. An alarm clock stood on the table, and this was one of the agents pretending he was connecting by telegraph to the Kaiser in America. This is a story about immigration to Brazil. If they were willing to accept this new group, the ringing of the clock supposedly signaled agreement. So you could see the steamship company was ripping these people off, tricking them, probably getting them to pay a little bit of extra money to get permission, et cetera, to be grateful to them. The people in Nahachewsky, which is now a famous city for other reasons, a famous town for other reasons, it's Auschwitz. This agency would not rest until the emigrant had left the bulk of his money. He was duped when he was buying his ticket, when he was changing money, and when they sold him all kinds of cheap clothes at triple the value, having convinced him that he had to buy them. And here's one that comes from a letter. I'm picking kind of extreme cases on purpose. As soon as we got off the train in Berlin, and went into the railroad station, we were taken through the city. It was like some kind of paradise. Right away, the agent's representative took us by coach to the agent whose address we had. He took us to the place where the agent lived, and we bought a steamship ticket from him. In Bremen, we were taken from the coaches to the director's office to have that steamship ticket issued, and then we were escorted to the hotel where we paid just one mark. Even though we had to wait for several extra days, it was without cost to us. No one had to pay a penny because the room and board were provided for us at the expense of the travel agency. So the first one talks really, it's a history, and it talks really about how the steamship agents were just horrible people. And the second one is a letter, and it talks about how the steamship agents really did their job nicely. So I want to concentrate on not what happened so much in 1890 and 1898, but I want to talk about what happened when the author was writing. So I want to explore the author's bias in these narratives. I concentrate on motifs about the journey, as I've said, and I really want to concentrate specifically on the steamship agents, because I noticed all over the place in the historical descriptions, the steamship agents were treated very, very poorly. They were very negatively depicted. The kind of cliche story is how bad the steamship agents were. So I'm going to do a science experiment. I take two contrasting types of sources, and I want to compare them and see if I can learn more about, is it the same everywhere? How does this all work? So I took a collection of letters. They were collected by a guy called Witold Kula from an archives. They were all written within a 3 month period or 6 month period, 1890 to 1891. They didn't arrive at the destination, but they were confiscated by the mail censors in the Congress Kingdom of Poland. And then they got left in a warehouse, and then they got put in archives. And then Kula found them in 1941 during World War II. And he took some of them home, and then thousands of other ones burned during the Warsaw Uprising in 1944. But in any event, we have 352 letters from that time, and they're not edited for their content, but Kula published every letter in full text, which is really a valuable thing. The Congress Kingdom of Poland was the kind of the country just north of Galicia. So it wasn't exactly the Habsburg Empire, and the laws were different. So it's not exactly perfect for the comparison with the popular histories, because I chose three popular histories written a lot later. And their popular histories are also more specifically about Ukrainians coming to Canada. So I have not a perfect match, but I have two corpuses that complement or contrast with each other. And then what did I do with these? I read each one very carefully, and I coded every reference to a person or organization who influenced the migrants during the journey. And I ended up with 724 references to people that influenced the migrants. I've already said that the data sample's imperfect. I'm not comparing apples and apples a little bit. Well, maybe I'm comparing Macintosh apples with golden delicious apples, because the location is a little bit different. The dates don't match perfectly. The place where they were emigrating to don't match perfectly. Polish writers versus Ukrainian writers, or Ukrainian as subjects of the histories. So it's not exactly a perfect match, but I'd like to argue it's close enough that we can make some decent observations. I did not find good histories about the Polish emigration from the Congress Kingdom of Poland so that I could get a nicer match with the letters, nor did I find a good collection of unedited, unbiased letters dealing with Ukrainians in Canada, which would have been my preference because it would have been apples and apples, real apples and apples. And then another possible source of problems in my methodology is that I could have done something in the coding that's wrong and gotten the letters, the numbers a little bit different. But with 724, I think I have enough volume that I can actually see some patterns in there. And I'd like to explain that patterns. And boom, the big thing that I was looking for happened with spades. The letters wrote about the steamship companies quite a lot, and they were 75% positive. The histories wrote about the steamship companies even more, and they were 3% positive. So a huge difference in the way the letters and in the way the histories perceived each other. And for the rest of the presentation, I want to untangle that, unwrap that a little bit so that we can start understanding why the heck is it so, so different. So in unpacking it, I want to go through four perhaps stages in the next half hour or so. The first thing I did was take a look at what kind of agents were being referred to in each of the sources. The second thing was, how were they described? Were they positively or were they negatively described? The third thing is, were these references specific references or were they generic ones? And the fourth one is really try to get into the bias of when the authors are writing. So I will start with the first one. So when I was doing the coding, it took me a long time to really settle on who the heck an agent was. In the end, I settled on a system where I had 13 different categories of agents there. The key one that I want to talk about most is the steamship companies, the one that's bold in the middle there. But the family was also very often a really important agent. Sometimes the family discouraged the people from traveling. Sometimes they were neutral. Sometimes they encouraged them. Sometimes they paid for them. All kinds of relationships there where the family had quite a bit of agency influencing the travelers. Other migrants helping, hindering, just traveling together with. The migrants themselves sometimes were kind of philosophical and said, gee whiz, I should have done that better. Or if this happens, then I'll do that. So I had an extra category for the migrants themselves as agents in their own, influencing their own travel. New country and old country governments obviously were quite important. Corporations in the new countries deserved its own thing because it behaved a little bit differently. And then there were miscellaneous different individuals or organizations in the old country, such as the famous Joseph Olesko, various charitable societies that operated both in the Habsburg Empire and other ones operated in the Congress Kingdom of Poland. Smugglers were a kind of special kind of agent, hoteliers, money exchangers, mail censors. And here's how often they were spoken about. Really quite a strong differentiation in the letters. New country government was the most commonly mentioned. First of all, they made it possible for the migration to happen at all because of the different rules allowing immigration into Brazil and the United States and eventually into Canada. The rules they set up, the idea that sometimes they supported the travel, they gave free land, sometimes they supported the inland travel, etc. That was really high on the mind of the letter writers, and they wrote about them a lot. Family members, as I've said, the whole style of writing a letter at that time, Thomason's Znanetsky, the famous sociologist from Chicago from the 1920s around that area, wrote a big, big set of studies about Polish immigration to the United States. And they used letters an awful lot in their research. And they called them bowing letters. You start by saying, praise be to Jesus Christ. How is your health? My health is okay. And then you have the central part of your letter, which deals with this happened to me, this I suggest you should do, how is that? And then you have the ending of the letter, which is, I bow to you, my wife, I bow to you, my parents, I bow to you, my brother and my sister-in-law, I bow to Uncle John, and the bowing happens, is a very, very important part of the letters. As Thomas and Znanetsky say, the whole idea is to keep the family connected. Letters were a new communication technology for most of these people, and physically leaving their family was very traumatic. So it was a way to try to keep the family glued together as much as he could. And you really see that in the letter. Besides that, the family members are also agents in the migration. So, and that's what's represented in this yellow bar. Shipping agents were talked about quite a bit. The contact with shipping agents was multiple. If you're thinking about emigrating, you perhaps write to them to get brochures or maps or something like that, or sometimes you see their advertisings. Then you talk about them with for the price. You actually commit the down payment on the ticket for the ship. They communicate to you and say when the ship is leaving, when you have to be in what city to get onto the ship. Then you have to actually physically get the ticket. Then they perhaps transfer you towards the harbor and get you on the ship and all these kind of things. So the shipping agents were engaging with the letter writers quite often, and you can see that in the frequency of their communications about them and how that they're really on their mind. And the other 10 are much, much less than 10% each. Smugglers were quite important there. I found them interesting because they were also quite positive. Old country government is not such a big, important kind of agent reference there. And that surprised me a little bit. I think the reason why the letter writers didn't write about the old country government very much is most of the relations they had with old country government agents, such as the village councillor or the mayor or something like that, where you needed to get your passport, or the gendarmes who were working there, is because most of those interactions happened before the people departed from their hometown or their home village. So most of that they communicated to their family members before they left, and they didn't have to write it in the letters. And then the other ones are also there, but quite small in terms of frequency. And now if I add the frequency in the histories for those same categories, that's the blue lines, you'll see, wow, really quite different. The most important thing that I hope you notice here, and the thing that to take away from it, is that the most frequent ones don't match. Some of the ones that are frequent for the letter writers are not so important for the historians, family members, for example. And the other way around too, sometimes the blue line is way longer than the yellow line is. If we just take a look at the three kind of most dominant ones that are spoken in the histories, and that's for sure the shipping agents, by far the most common one there. The historians are just really fixated on the shipping agents as powerful influences of the travelers. The second most important one for the historians is the old country miscellaneous helpers. There's a lot written, especially about Joseph Olescu, about his brochures, about various societies that are engaged in perhaps trying to help the migrants travel. So that's the second most common one in the histories. And what a big contrast with the letter writers themselves. And then the third one in the histories is the new country government. Well, it really was the new country government that made it possible for them to travel. So they're important there. And the other ones are smaller. Quite interesting. The historians are not at all interested in the smugglers. That's because of my methodological problem. Galicia didn't have a ban on emigration, so you didn't need to hire a smuggler to get you across the border to get out. The same with the mail censors, that's not really an issue in the context the historians are writing, so that's why those ones don't match. So some of the non-matching is my methodological, my data source problem, but a lot of it is because they were interested in different things. So that's the first thing that I wanted to talk about is frequency. And the one thing you're supposed to take home from that is the letter writers and the historians are interested in different kinds of agents. The second one is positive versus negative. I made a chart about which of these categories is spoken about the most positively, the most encouragingly, and which ones were spoken as negative people. So the money exchangers, you never talk about a money exchanger unless he ripped you off. The mail censors, what is their possibly good thing to say about somebody stealing your letter? So those ones are 100% negative. On the positive side, at the top of the page, you have family, which was really positively described in the letters, not only during the bowing sections, because I didn't code the bowing sections, because that's not about agency, but as agents, the family was really, really appreciated. And the new country government, strongly above average. The steamship agents and the steamship companies were also above average in the way the letter writers described them. They described them as people that helped them get to where they were trying to go, which is something that really struck me very strongly. And that's something we have to kind of unpack. The smugglers, interestingly, were average. They were people that helped me get to where I go. And I think that's a good thing for us to remember. The letter writers were not so concerned about what the difference between legal and semi-legal and illegal activities. They really took it from their own perspective. If I am wanting to do this, then who is going to help me and who's going to get in my way? Very often the legal things were negative and the illegal things were positive. And they didn't kind of connect legality and morality in that situation. And maybe none of us do today either, but that might be less than intuitive for some of us. I certainly wanted to think about that for quite a bit. And the last point I wanted to make on this slide is the idea that a lot of them are somehow nuanced. Some of them are extremely strongly above or extremely strongly below, but many of them are somewhere in the middle. Sometimes they're positively described, sometimes they're negatively described, kind of around average. And that's really characteristic for the letters. There were also a lot of descriptions in the letters where I couldn't decide whether it was positive or negative. You really get the feeling that these people are being awashed by all these amazing experiences, and some things they thought were going to be good ended up not being good, and some things they thought, oh, that's danger, ended up being wonderful. And so they're really unsettled and unsure and really evaluating and kind of sometimes postponing their decision whether something is good or bad. They're kind of halfway in between and hesitating in terms of their estimation of positiveness. Something like 25% of the comments in the letters, I couldn't score as either positive or negative, but I put somewhere in between. But now let's overlay the historians there. And on that last point, the historians were quite different. They were either super against or super for. And there's a few of them that were intermediate, but they were much more kind of positivist and much more opinionated than the letter writers were. Family was again very positive. New country government was a little bit positive, but not nearly as much as the letter writers talked about the new country government. But look at the third one, the steamship companies and the steamship agents. That one is the most extreme difference between the positive treatment of the letter writers, or at least the softly positive one, and the absolutely negative treatment of the historians. Very, very strong. And that's out of 134 comments. So there was lots of kind of weight behind the classification there. There were a couple of other ones that were extremely differently written. That's the other migrants, where the blue line is going to the right side, but the yellow side is going to the left. And the emigrant themselves. Very interesting. The three strongest positives for the historians were the emigrant themselves, the other migrants that were traveling along with them, and their family. Everybody else are kind of bad guys. This feeling that you get by reading the histories is these poor, kind of tormented, suffering, unfortunate people are forced to go out, and they're helping each other whenever they can. Their family helps them whenever they can, but really it's us against the world. So the only positive ones are these people that are actually either peasants or proletarian, the lower class people that are traveling for the most part. The letter writers were not particularly intelligentsia or anything like that in this particular collection. And the history is just really quite negative about a lot of the different things, some of them more, some of them less, some of them about the same as the history writers. So that's the second angle that I looked at that. At the data from, and it was quite interesting. The takeaway from there is, again, I should go back for a second. Again, the historians and the letter writers are not voting about the different categories of migrants the same way. Their interests and their opinions really, really are quite different from each other. So that's the takeaway from that one. And the third kind of point of analysis are the question of specific versus generic references. This one's going to end up being a lot more important than I expected. A specific reference will be when the agent, a specific agent is mentioned, some kind of action happens at a specific place in a specific time to a specific person, usually the letter writer themselves, and they're really dominant in the letters. 87% of the letters, references to agents, are very specific. And that's the home base for the letters. The letters really are usually a person writing to family or friends back home, and they're talking in the middle part of their letter about what happened to them in the last 48 hours or the last week or the last month or something like that. So the home base for letters is the specific comments, and the general ones are added in. About 13% of the comments in the letters are generic ones that say, well, I know that the steamship agents usually rip people off, but for us, we got away without losing money on it or something like that. So they had a generic comment, and then they made a specific comment about it, or the other way around, the specific one came first. In the histories, it's really quite different, because the historians are not trying to explain what happened to one family. The historians are trying to explain what happened to a couple hundred thousand people over a decade. So their home base is really the generic comments. And that's where their focus and their worldview really is. And when they do have specific references in the history letters, that's because they usually started out with a particular broad statement, and then they want to give kind of authority to it. So they give a specific example to support their generic statement. So here's an example of Michael Iwanchuk's quotation from there. He starts off with a really nice generic thing. Many were bilked of their money along the way. Some were even given useless American script in change. We don't know how many, we don't know where, we don't know when. It's a generic topic, repeating something that somebody had said before, probably somebody had said before that, somebody before that. So it's not that far from, it's not that grounded, but it's on this continuum with a fact that I'm sure happened many times, all the way to rumor, right? The minute they started to make plans to emigrate, unscrupulous agents like vultures descended on them. And then he gives a concrete example after that to strengthen, to support, to ground his general assertion. So he writes a specific example. Not far away, there was a poor man's cabin. He arrived in Winnipeg with only 4 cents in his pocket. Very specific, very individual, even though we don't know that person's name. And he showed them to me, which is Reverend Metu saying this, saying that he would carry them on his person to the end of his life. This, Padre, he said, is the last drop of my blood. So he starts with generic and he ends with a specific to reinforce the generic. Actually, this is a nice example because Dumitriu does that same thing too. So Dumitriu starts with generic things and then gives a concrete example. So we have a specific that's embedded into a generic that's embedded into another generic. That's a good strategy for the historians to use, this kind of specific generic relationship, because they can choose which specific example they want. They only choose the ones that reinforce their generic statements. They don't choose the ones that go against it, do they? The key thing that's happening here is the generic ones are always more negative than the specific ones. I've made a chart here of the generic ones that are more negative than the overall. And the bottom one is Isaac Telman, who wrote one of the histories. He's from Ukraine. He was the most negative by far. And his generic is half as positive as his overall comments. But Iwanchuk too, his generic comments are much more often negative. Even in the letters, when the letter writers are writing their generic comments, they're quite a bit more negative than their overall ones, which include their specific ones. The specific ones are, what happened to me? I remember this. And the generic ones are, well, how do I feel generally about this topic? What have I heard before? What's kind of in my background, previous position before my experience happened to me? So I kind of talk about the generic ones are describing what's in the air more than what happened to me. And Marina Hrimich, who wrote a beautiful big book about Ukrainians going to Brazil, she proposes that we should think about this 19th century Galician intelligentsia discourse competing against the popular discourse. There were two kinds of descriptions of migration in the period of the 1880s and the 1890s. The popular discourse was, oh man, things are crappy here. I wish we could go, oh, there's a wonderful other place somewhere out there. Maybe let's go. The popular discourse, which was influenced by the steamship agents, et cetera, was quite pro-migration and positive. And the intelligentsia discourse was generally anti-immigration and lots of warnings, be careful, this is gonna happen, be careful that. If you're a newspaper in Galicia in the 1890s, you're getting correspondence from people who have emigrated. You can't publish the positive ones because it's against the law to encourage emigration. Emigration itself isn't illegal, but encouraging it is. So you publish the negative ones. Guys like Joseph Olesko says, don't go to Brazil. There's terrible things happening there. And if you're going to go to Canada, be careful. There's all kinds of things you have to worry about in terms of that too. So the intelligentsia discourse is in the air and it's quite negative. And it affects, I think, everybody, all three of my sources. So for the letter writers, memory is the core. And for the historians, it's their pre-established worldview, what's in the air, and information from their research sources, whatever sources are accessible to them. And now the fourth kind of way of approaching this question are the author's biases themselves. I wonder if I can get somehow under the skin of these documents or in between the lines to understand them a little bit more. And I think I have some ways of accessing that a little bit from this. If we're very positivist, we should say, we could imagine that 160,000, 260, 360,000 migrants from Central Europe coming at that time. But are we really talking about the same agents and the same events that actually happened? Is there something that should and could be described as true and balanced about them? If there is a balanced, true description that we're hoping for, why are these descriptions so different? So let's see if we can go into that. The first thing to say about that is each of the authors have a narrative arc. They have a reason for writing that document in the first place. And I've already talked about the bowing letter for the letters. The key narrative arc of most of these letters is to keep family ties connected. And also secondarily to describe what has happened, make recommendations, maybe they want to bring other family members to migrate as well after them, etc. Each different individual letter writer has his or her own particular intention with this particular letter. Some of them are really happy, some of them are really sad, some of them really encouraged, some of them really discouraged. Some of them had really good news to say. Other people said, my child died on the transportation, so they were really sad about it. So we can't really talk about the narrative arc other than retaining the family ties and describing what happened. And so that I made in a little, on the right side, the little red arrows. Many, many little arrows in this collection, 350 arrows if they could fit on a page. But the histories are a different thing. The histories, instead of 350 authors writing 400 pages, now you have one author writing 400 pages. So the perception and the control that Iwanchuk and Tengman have is much stronger and much different than the letter writers. Iwanchuk has a certain narrative arc that has to be in his book. And actually, we have two books from Iwanchuk in this study that I quoted, and both of them are really identical. The peasants and the workers in the villages, in the towns, in Central Europe really had a tough lot. Sometimes they were really hungry. They certainly didn't have enough land to make a decent living, and the rules were set against them. And then there was this opportunity, they thought, to make their life better. They were pretty desperate, so they went out. It was really hard. It stayed being desperate. The journey was difficult. The destination countries were overrepresented by the advertisements and by the agents and by each other's rumor and by their hope. So the first years were really difficult. The journey was terrible and difficult. And the first years, the pioneering years, if they were in the country, or the getting a job if they were in the city, were tough, tough, tough. But they heroically persevered and they did better. And eventually they really got established. And eventually they really found a home there. And their children lived much better. And their grandchildren lived much better again. So for Iwanchuk, you really have this rags to riches story that happens over 125 years or so. And that's something that's fundamental to Iwanchuk writing. He couldn't not write that. He had to write that big narrative arc. And he had to make his generic comments fit that arc. And he had to choose his specific comments to fit that arc as well. In the Soviet Union, Telman was writing in the 1950s. This was a time when socialist realism was super, super strong. He had even a stronger narrative arc that he must follow. He agreed with Iwanchuk. In the 19th century, the peasants and the workers were getting exploited terribly. We had industrial capitalism growing, and that was just ripping them off terribly, terribly. They were hungry, they were sick, it was just horrible. And so out of desperation, those poor people had to flee to try to do something better. But the place where they were fleeing was also capitalist. And they continued ripping them off. The new country was not some kind of utopia, but it was a horrible place too, that led to even more suffering. And while they were traveling, the vultures would pick at them as well. And it was terrible, terrible. If only they wouldn't have emigrated. If they would have only stayed a little bit longer, then it could have been the time when the Soviet Union had control of Ukraine and things would be much better for them. And they would live happily ever after, according to Telman's narrative arc. And this was not negotiable. Telman couldn't tell a different story. He couldn't give strong evidence that conflicted with that story. He had to say that. So for Telman, it was a rags to rags trajectory that needed to happen. And I tried to draw that with my little red arrow. Okay, so we have a little bit too much theoretical talking, and let's get to some kind of concrete thing. So I'd like to go through a few more quotations, examples from the letters and from other sources to see if I can get under the skin of the letter writers, because the last 5 minutes I was talking about under the skin of Iwanchuk and Telman. So now, some people wrote their letters perhaps stretching the truth or emphasizing one part of the truth because they really, their desire was to encourage other people to migrate. So Brazil is not as bad as it was. The heat waves are not so intolerable. We live in a temperate climate. Most of them, of course, settled in the southern part of Brazil, which is hotter than Galicia was, but not as hot as the Amazon, et cetera, not in the tropics. It's only semi-tropic there. And then in the letter, it says, so come to us as soon as possible, because here there's a livelihood for you, but not there. So they're trying to encourage more migration. And I can imagine that if there was really a heat wave, he would kind of underplay that in this writing. That's by Nat Kalinowski there. Another reason why they might have biased the text of the letters themselves is because they thought that bringing more migrants would help their own problems. So this isn't from a letter, this is from actually quite a famous personal experience narrative by Maria Adamowska, which was published several times. Our host had been writing letters to us about the great prosperity that he had attained in such a short time, and this is in rural Canada. He said that he had a home like a mansion, a large cultivated field, and that his wife was dressed like a lady. So these people's friends bought tickets and ended up finally, after a long, difficult journey, arriving at this host's house. How great was our disenchantment! He was grubbing up some stumps near the house, and his wife was poking away in the garden. She reminded us of Robinson Crusoe on an uninhabited island. When mother saw this scarecrow, she started to cry again. Later on, father reprimanded the man for writing us such nonsense, but his only answer was, let someone else have a taste of our good life here. I think that the host, the person who wrote quite false letters, making them more positive than reality, was because he thought if there would be more people coming, they would sooner end up with kind of a livable life. A third quote, another reason why I think the letters were sometimes written more positively than in reality, it's just because the people didn't know that they got ripped off. This is actually Josef Olescu writing. Of the several hundred German emigrants I asked about how much they paid for their travel tickets, I think he just went talking to them up and down in the railroad platform. It turns out that almost all of them paid more than was necessary, or else they were traveling on a longer, more expensive route. Often they paid 20 golden Rinsky more than they should have per person. And those were Germans who get by everywhere more easily than our people. Of course, they were traveling through a German-speaking territory as they were traveling in Europe on their way to the ships. So Olescu is arguing that almost everybody got ripped off. So it would be unusual if the positive descriptions of the steamship agents were 80% in the letters in the collection that we're looking at today. So probably more than 20% of them got ripped off, but maybe some people wrote a positive letter because they just didn't realize they got ripped off. And then another factor that comes up a number of times is the fact that the steamship agents themselves might have written the letters. Telman has a really kind of a vibrant quotation here. Nodari is one of the agents. Dozens of this agent's people were busy in Brazil, in Udine, in Genoa, and on location in Galicia and Bukovina, collecting addresses and sending out counterfeit letters in the name of former neighbors, acquaintances, and relatives. Recognizing somebody's handwriting wasn't so important because many people used a scribe, etc. So they could get away with these counterfeit letters that gave very positive information about immigration, because that would mean that the steamship agents would have more customers. Sometimes they literally forged a letter from scratch, and sometimes they were just prompted. There are some descriptions of, in the steamship agent's office, he offered me a $10 discount if I would write a letter to my family recommending him for their migration, or something like that. Either a discount or some kind of bonus, or different kinds of incentives from the steamship agents so that the letter would be written more positively than it might have been written without their influence. Whew. So to kind of summarize those things, the core of the letter writer's text is specific recent experiences, but the various forms of bias of them, I've listed five here. The male censors for this particular collection, the male censors confiscated letters that promoted emigration. So these letters already from the get-go survived because they were confiscated, and were selected because they were too positive. So I put that in square brackets because that's not a bias of the letter writer, but it's a bias collection. Sometimes the letter writers wanted to encourage migration. They thought more migrants will help them in their own particular predicament. Sometimes the letters were more positive because of forgery or prompting by the steamship agents, and sometimes because they were ignorant of being swindled. If we take a look at each of those different factors, the little red arrows are pointing up if they're trying to make the letter sound more positive, and down if they make the letter sound more negative. Well, there are specific recent experiences. Some were good, some were neutral, and some were bad. But each one of these different forces that helped bias the letters tended to make the letters sound more positive. There were some factors that I think are smaller ones. They're in brackets on the very bottom. Some migrants were just scared, so everything was scary. Sometimes they heard rumors. Sometimes an agent would say bad things about another agent, and that would be something that could be negative that could end up being found in a letter. and then the access to the various negative publications, the letters from the various charitable societies warning against immigration, and the letters in the newspapers warning against immigration, etc. So the letter writers are the letters that we read here, and my coding for them is biased in for a lot of different ways, and almost all of those biases send them higher and higher into more positive territory. The historians also have biases as well. They have their own pre-existing worldview. They don't have memory as their core kind of base. They have the intentions of the author and then the data that they find during their research. The narrative arc is a kind of a bias. Political correctness in the time of writing is a bias. Inherited 19th century intelligentsia, most of that is all negative, negative, negative. Even Joseph Olescu, when he talks about Brazil in his three different publications, it's absolutely negative. When he talks about you should go Canada instead, he says, well, that's not perfect. And he warns a lot about Canada as well. So Olescu's thing is three quarters negative as well. And then the research sources available to those historians at that time. Telemann, for example, writing in the Soviet Union, has a lot more sources from Central Europe, obviously, than he has access to Canadian or Brazilian or American sources. Iwanchuk, obviously, has a lot more sources that are Canadian-based archives, et cetera, and he doesn't have the archives in Vienna or Lviv, for example. So the resources available are also biasing the historians. Other histories that they've written, and then the specific things that they read. And if I try to draw arrows, do those different biases affect it one way or the other? I see that almost all of them are either neutral or they're drawing the historians into a downward kind of a direction in terms of how they'll choose the words to say the next sentence or the next paragraph or the next chapter of their book. And there are some things that make the historians kind of go more positive. I would love to do a research project extending this to explore poetic license. What about the nonfiction or the fiction texts about this migration? Are they positive or are they negative? Academic historians, for example, might be really interested in discovering something really new that no other historian has ever discovered before. So they might really want to try to be innovative as an academic and find out all kinds of positive things about this. So there might be some things changing that, but by and large, the majority of bias factors end up making the historians more negative. Whew. And that I think is why we end up with such crazy differences in the descriptions of the steamship companies and in the letters and in the histories. I don't think it's possible that we can unwrap this all the way to the end and find out the importance of one of those seven or eight factors more important and the other one less important, because they changed from author to author and they changed from text to text and they changed from situation to situation. And they also change from reader to reader, because I might have coded something as positive that you might think is neutral or the other way around, for example. So there we go. That's my presentation. Thank you very much.